I haven't been back to Haynes Crossing since my wife died 4 years ago. I thought I had severed all ties with the town, but moral duty has a funny way of sneaking up on you. I never understood why Charlie stayed there, though now that I think about it, I never really understood anything about my brother. There was a time when I would have done anything for him. Now the best I can do is show up to put him in the ground. It's a lonely ride back to Haynes Crossing. And when I get there, I'll be alone. No friends, no family, no past. Nearly everything I remember about this place, I want to forget. Though I can't say all the memories were bad. Even the devil started out innocent. When we were kids, you couldn't separate me and Charlie. We were always on some make-believe adventure. We were secret agents, cowboys and Indians, even cops and robbers. That was Charlie's favorite. Charlie had an extraordinary imagination. The only problem was that he never had a true grip on reality. No one knew Charlie like I did. They never saw the things I witnessed growing up. He would have these episodes. One minute he'd be playing, and the next minute he'd be living in his fantasy. Oftentimes, his fantasies were violent. I remember one day in particular. I was about 9 and a half. Charlie must have been about 7. I lost him in the woods for about a half hour. And when I found him, he was all bloody kneeling over something. It was Booker, our neighbor's golden retriever. I never spoke of that day. Now, I wish I had. Sometimes I think the whole town knew what happened, but they just acted like it was business as usual. The police report concluded that an intruder entered my home, overpowered Charlie, and killed Susan, my wife. But nothing was taken, and no suspect was ever brought in. I can never understand how he did it, and I don't think I'll ever forgive him. All I know for sure is that Charlie is gone. Maybe now I can get on with my life.